Hello, whistleblowers everywhere. So today I thought I would have a chat and give you some examples of some of the issues when you're first starting to learn a tune. So today's tune, it's kind of a tune breakdown, but I want to concentrate more on approach and also focus on some of the issues that a lot of beginners find when they're approaching a tune. So there's some kind of common mistakes or common things that beginner whistlers may try and do which will not be helpful. And I'm going to go through a few of those using this tune. Now this tune is it's played in several different ways, but this is a tune called the Eagle's Whistle. And this one is written in 3/4. There are other versions. And sometimes it's even played as a kind of 2/4 march, which I've heard the same tune played, but this is a fairly straightforward tune. And I thought I'd use this tune, the Eagle's Whistle, as an example of how to approach some of the things that are necessary in terms of phrasing, in terms of articulation. Now, I'm not going to be using any kind of finger ornamentation at all in this, because this is just basic stuff. And what's really important when you're learning a tune is to get a good grasp of the melody and the rhythm. The ornamentation is really kind of a personal preference, and there's lots and lots of ways you can ornament a tune, and there's lots and lots of ways you can ornament this tune. But for the purposes of this video, I'm going to keep it very, very simple. And we're going to talk a little bit about phrasing and about tonguing. And about how you build up your phrases. And so I'm going to talk briefly about how I would approach this particular tune, just to learn the tune, and some helpful hints. So here we go. This is the tune called The Eagle's Whistle. And I'm going to do kind of a mini breakdown because, as I said, I'm not going to be going into ornamentation on this. This is just purely about beginning approach of learning a new tune. So I'm going to play it through slowly, and then I'm going to tell you what I'm doing and how I'm approaching it in terms of using some very basic tonguing. Now you'll notice I'm only going to tongue to separate the notes that are the same. I'm not going to use cuts, which is more traditional, but I'm just going to use some tonguing to separate those notes. I'm going to assume that as a beginner you don't know any about any articulation, and you don't know about cuts or taps or rolls or any of the sort of traditional Irish music ornamentation. And at this stage, it's probably, when you're learning a tune, the best thing to do is to keep that completely out of the picture and just learn the tune in its most basic form. So this is what I'm going to do, and I'm going to go point out some, maybe some beginner's mistakes which you may be making. So here we go, the Eagle's Whistle. So in terms of tonguing, what we're going to do is we're only going to use our tongue for two reasons. One is to articulate the first note after a breath, and two, it's to separate notes which are the same without using cuts. Now, most times in traditional music, often we'll separate notes which are the same by using a cut, but because we're not really dealing with any of those ornaments in this tutorial, what we're going to do is you're going to separate the notes which are the same by lightly tonguing. Now, tonguing, if it's done too heavily, it leaves too much of a gap between the notes. I'm going to show you what I mean by this. So if I'm tonguing, say, the scale of D, so I was tonguing every note in that scale. I'll do it again. So you could hear that there were notes were interrupted by the tongue, but what we don't want to do is to do a heavy kind of tonguing where there's a gap between each note like this. Uh, So light, gentle tonguing. What I'm doing is I'm very lightly touching the roof of my mouth with my tongue to get that separation. So the scale of D again with what we call legato tonguing. So it's important to get used to that sort of legato smooth tonguing. We don't want to have too much of a heavy kind of accent or tonguing. All the tonguing is doing is gently touching the roof of your mouth, just behind your teeth. So you're going. If it's too heavy, then you get this kind of weighted note separation, which sounds a bit clumsy. So with tonguing, it's always good to be able to do what we call legato tonguing. So if I'm going to play like a simple G arpeggio, if I do it slurred first, I'm going to tongue each note with smooth legato tonguing. Matching up your tonguing with your fingering is very important too. So you need to do the two things exactly at the same time. So slowly. It's a good idea to practice that legato smooth tonguing. What we don't want is this. And there, all the notes are separated with a gap, and we don't want that gap. We want it to flow smoothly. So again, legato tonguing is really important to be able to do that because it adds to the flow, it adds to the smoothness of the overall tune. So I'm going to set my metronome to 60, and I'm going to play this tune through for you twice. Now, I'm going to play it with the repeats because that's quite important and integral to this piece of music. So here's the eagle's whistle at 60. So here's my click. One, two, three. One, two, three. Okay, so in terms of your breathing and taking a breath, again, what you want to try and do is to build it up in phrases. Now this tune works nicely because the phrases are fairly even. So for the first two bars, you can play those in one long phrase. So I'm only going to use the tonguing to separate notes which are the same. So the first two bars. Now you may need to take a breath there at the end of the second bar, or you may be able to carry it on, and it's up to your capacity, where it's where you feel comfortable. But you don't really want to be breathing in between a phrase because it adds a little bit of unevenness to that playing. So I can probably quite comfortably get through to the third or fourth bar at that speed. So Now, if you noticed, I did the first A part and did the repeat. Now, where I took a breath wasn't particularly at the end of a bar or end of a phrase. I took a breath there on a certain note which didn't interrupt the flow of the tune, and it was a natural breathing space. So in terms of your breathing, I've got now, you can take a breath at the end of that last D on the last bar, but if you're playing it quicker, you're going to have to really be quick with your breathing because you don't have a lot of time. So if you can extend that breathing to the after the F, the first note of the second line on the first bar, then you've got a little bit more chance to get a breath going there. So we've got... On the second time bar, that long note, yeah, you can take a breath after that. So try and make your breathing work for you, and try and make sure that it doesn't interfere with the timing, it doesn't displace the beat in any way, and also that it doesn't displace the phrasing, it doesn't make it sound odd or strange. So the breathing, yeah, is really important to make it flow and not to displace the time or the tempo. Okay, so in terms of tonguing, again, like I said, I'm only tonguing on the first note after I've taken a breath, or I'm tonguing the notes for separation that are the same. I'm not going to tongue every note. What you don't want to do, and I know quite a few beginners, when they first start off, they're under the impression that they need to tongue every note, and that really isn't a good habit to build. What you want to do is, in terms of getting the flow going, is get good finger articulation. So what we don't want is this. Now, if you like that effect, that's fine, then go ahead and do that. Again, there's no rights and wrongs, but to my ear, I prefer the flowing, more legato-tongued version with those long phrases. So, to me, that sounds a lot more pleasing to the ear than having that sort of almost semi-staccato tongued, heavy tongued way of playing. So yeah, be aware of your tonguing, be aware of trying to develop that nice legato sort of tongue, which is important in playing whistle. Okay, so when I have a look at the B part now, so the first two measures. So in terms of the fingering for the D, it's much better to try and get into the habit of using that D. It tends to be overall more stable and a cleaner kind of sounding D. You can, and I do oftentimes use that D if I'm playing something very quickly and the D is a passing note. I call it a cheat D, but it's much better if at all possible to try and get into the habit of playing your middle D. Some people call this high D, but I call it middle D because you've got a D all the way up there. So that's what I call the middle D and the low D. So for this middle D, yeah, always try and finger it with the top finger off. It's a good habit to get into, and especially It's a more stable note and it's less prone to cracking. So I got to that D, sorry, the B on the first bar of the last line, and then I'm going to take a breath after that. So then you can take a breath after that long D. And so we repeat it. And then we'll repeat with the second time bar to go back to the beginning again. So that's the eagle's whistle. So I'm going to play it through again, and I'm going to play it through with each phrase and where I'm going to put a breath in. And again, if it works for you, that's fine. If not, then you can use that rule to make sure that breathing doesn't interfere with the flow or the rhythm of the piece. So here we go. I'm going to play it through again with breathing. But what I'll do is I'll do a little pause when I've taken a breath, just to highlight exactly where I'm breathing. Here we go. One, two, three. Breath. 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 And so at the last long note, the dotted half note D. I'm just shaving a little bit off that long note to take a breath. So the B part now. Breath. Breath, and then follow it around again if you're doing it more than one time around. And then the last, you basically end it on the first time bar when you play it through the last time. So you just play the first time bar twice. Okay, so I'm going to play it through now again with the click, and I'm going to breathe in those places which I showed you just now where I played through it. Okay, so clicks at 60, off we go. One, two, three. Okay, so those are the breathing spaces that work for me. However, they may not work on a low whistle or a different kind of whistle, one which has more of an air hungry kind of need. Different whistles have different air requirements, different bores, different sized whistles. So what might work on one whistle may not work on another. So it's a good idea to get into the habit of figuring out what works for you in terms of the whistle that you play, in terms of your breath capacity, and also in terms of whether or not the whistle is being played in a much higher register or a lower register. Now, with this tune, it doesn't really go above a high or a middle D, but if you're playing a lot more in the higher register, you have to push air through the whistle at a faster rate, so therefore you're required to breathe at a slightly higher pressure. So again, your breathing will change dependent upon which register you're playing in as well. So work out what works best for you. So if I'm going to do this tune again, and say if I'm doing it on a much more air hungry whistle, I might need to breathe more often, so I might need to do this. Now, also, if I'm playing this at a much slower tempo, supposing I'm playing this half that speed, then I'm going to need to breathe more. So, if I'm doing this at a much slower tempo, so it's okay to breathe more often, and more frequently as and when you need to. If you're running out of air, you need to take a breath. But it's better to take a breath at the end of a longer note or the end of a phrase, rather than breaking up a phrase and taking a breath in a place which may displace the tempo. So yeah, it's important to think about your breathing and to think about where would be a good place to breathe rather than leaving it up to chance. It's always a good idea to plan ahead at this stage where you think you may need to take a breath. So just a summary regarding approaching a tune like the Eagle's Whistle. Yeah, think about the phrases, think about where you're going to breathe, and also think about the keeping the flow going, and the most important thing is keeping the tempo steady. And yeah, it's helpful sometimes to work with a metronome. You may want to give it a try. It's a helpful tool, but like any other tool, it's good to use it wisely. I wouldn't use it all the time, especially when you're learning a tune at first. It's probably not helpful when you're learning the notes, but it's really important to keep everything at a steady tempo. So that's about it, really. Eagle's whistle. So tonguing, we want to try and get that legato smooth tonguing. And again, a little exercise in tonguing which you can do is just going up and down the scale. Try it slurred first and then try doing it all tongued, and there shouldn't be any sort of discernible gaps between the notes. So slurred. Now, when I tongue, you want to keep that tonguing nice and light and legato. Now we want to avoid that kind of very heavy. Where there's all those gaps in between the note. Tonguing should be done smoothly, gently, and try and keep it really so it doesn't interrupt the flow of the music. Okay, I hope you found this tutorial, this basic tune breakdown of this tune called the Eagle's Whistle. As I said, I've avoided all kind of ornamentation. We've done note separation by using tonguing. We've talked quite a bit about breathing and finding what's a right breathing point for you in the music. Again, the golden rule is that it mustn't displace the tempo and it must keep the flow of the tune going. So have a go. And if you found this tutorial helpful, you may wish to su subscribe to my Whistleblowers channel. You can always give this video a like. And if you've got any questions, please fire away. I'm happy to answer those questions. So just ask me anything, really. And again, just a little shameless plug about the Whistle Club, which I'm hoping to start on the last Sunday of each month, starting this month, September. It's going to be at 6 o'clock on the last Sunday of each month. It's going to be about an hour long or so, and it only costs a fiver for each session. So £5 for each session, where we will be taking a tune, doing a tune breakdown, having a chat, and it's a chance for you to ask me any questions regarding your whistle playing, regarding technique, or anything to do with your whistle playing. So it's a good place to have a chat with me, ask some questions, have a chat with the other people that will be attending the Zoom class. And yeah, so that's the Whistle Club. Okay, folks, happy whistling and bye from me.